Hi everyone, hope everybody doing good. Thank you for joining with me today. Today I'm going to discuss about global Apache Hadoop compatible file system view with client-side mounts. My name is Uma. Before jumping onto the details, let me introduce myself. I'm working in Cloudera as a principal software engineer. I am also a software foundation member at Apache and a project management committee member at Hadoop and Bookkeeper and several other projects. And also I am a IPMC member and mentoring a couple of other projects and actively working on big data storage softwares, distributed file system and object store, Ozone, Apache Ozone. Here are my contact details in case if you want to in touch with me for any queries on this talk. Let me just look at any questions before that. Yeah, thank you. Let me jump onto the agenda. Let's discuss about, as a first topic, let's discuss about Hadoop compatible files, what we have today. This is a very interesting topic in Hadoop area. And also we'll discuss about distributed file system limitations and federation. And as well as a little bit, we'll touch on object store, that is Apache Ozone. Previous talks already covered most of the stuff, so we'll just quickly touch upon. And then actual topic is view file system. We'll look at its background and what challenges we had today and what solutions we came up with and how we solved that. And as well as we'll also look at the upstream. Then for last but one, we will look at it, a view distributed file system, why we need that. Last topic, we'll look at Hive partitioning use case. We'll go through step by step how we can execute that and get the results even though your data is in two different clusters. Let's look at Hadoop compatible file systems. The Hadoop compatible file systems is one of the important layer in Hadoop. So, many other file system clients has been integrated with the Hadoop. Initially, the in-house file system was HDFS, and many other file systems are just integrated as client-side layers, so that real stores will just stay there, and it will just connect from this Hadoop file system layer, so that. Provides the compatibility who was using HDFS before, they will be able to easily use other file systems. However, they need to change the scheme and URIs according to the respective file system. As I said, each file system has its own scheme. For example, if you want to use HDFS, you need to use HDFS as a scheme part. And if you want to use S3A, you need to use S3A as a scheme part. And so on. The other file systems are just client-side integrations. Hadoop file system layer doesn't have implementation of other file systems except HDFS. So they are just a client-side connector implementations. One of the in-house file system implementation available in Hadoop is distributed file system, as we all know. This scales very well and supports many use cases today. And most of the on-prem clusters run on HDFS today. And however, it has its own challenges and bottlenecks with respect to name node memory and block reports, especially. So the as per its design itself, like it keeps all the block space and namespace in the same single node, that's a name node. So it takes global lock and as well as it has to process the bulk block reports. So we had a lot of mitigations to solve that, but however, it still has a lot of challenges when the data node becomes dense. I mean, we keep the limitations as data node can have only 100 terabytes, something like that range. So if it is having more, then it starts storing more blocks, then the block report becomes heavier to process. So we see a lot of issues, challenges there. That point is like a dense data nodes really can't run. That's that meaning that data nodes having a lot of storage, they would suffer with the block reports. To solve these scalability issues, Hadoop came up with the federation, which you can run different namespaces. So you can partition your cluster in such a way that it has a different namespaces, and the data nodes can send the block reports, part of the block reports, to different namespaces. So this works well. However, users has to partition their namespace accordingly. The namespace would not be shared each other. They are independent. It's pretty much like independent cluster. Just pause on there, and we will look into Hadoop Apache Ozone details. Like this is a distributed object store, and it's a key value perspective store. So we can think this as like a next generation to the HDFS. It solves a lot of scalability issues, which we just discussed. And Ozone is designed and optimized primarily for big data workloads, architected by keeping all the HDFS limitations in mind, and they significantly reduce the block reports by having block container mechanism. It doesn't send each and every block level reports. It just sends like a container reports only. So the data node responsibility is to take care of its blocks itself and just tells the container level report to the SCM, storage container manager. We'll discuss in the next slide. That way the namespace and block space is completely separated, because in Ozone we have two building blocks, that is Ozone manager and then a storage container manager. So the storage container manager completely responsible for dealing these container reports, and that key space management is completely at the Ozone manager. And there is another key difference is like compared to S3 kind of stores. This is strongly consistent. Apache Ozone is strongly consistent and supports Kubernetes kind of environments. And let's look at the architecture briefly in a high level. As I discussed, it has store Ozone manager mainly to manage the key space, and then storage container manager, which is which mainly responsible for container reports and scheduling for the replications. It has a file system layer, which is mainly it works like a file system, like a distributed file system, how we have for HDFS. This implements the Hadoop file system layer, so Hadoop applications would be able to use easily this store as well. And we have already tested around billion objects test done. I mean, successfully it was able to manage billion, and we have plans to test more and more. We are in progress to do that. As I said, like the block reports are significantly reduced here, so we have eliminated the bottleneck in the container reports perspective. In the previous talk, Dinesh already mentioned that the container is meaning that it's not a Docker container or any other Kubernetes containers. It is a logical name for a batch of blocks at the data node. As I just discussed, it has a file system layer and it's a key value store. And the good news is that Ozone is GA now. It's a 1.0 is out. 1.0 release is already out, so you can have a try. So I'm coming to the main topic. So by the way, if you have any questions, meanwhile, I would take them at last. Please hold on. Thank you. The main topic is view file system background. Background in the sense like we will discuss the today what view file system is, and then what we how we have improved to support more use cases, and the especially high partitioning use case today. So the view file system is completely was a new file system. I mean, not now. I mean, it's already exist in the Hadoop itself. So it's a if users wanted to use it, they need to change their schemes and paths. It is mainly motivated from the HDFS Federation, because we split the namespace into multiple name nodes, so that there should be a way to easily manage multiple namespaces. So this is the implementation where you can configure multiple URIs as the mount points in view file system. So from the single file system source, you would be able to access all of underneath the name nodes. It's not limited to HDFS. Actually, the design supports any other Hadoop compatible file systems. So you can configure S3AR, ABFS, any other file system which we already integrated with Hadoop. You should be able to configure as a target mount point here. It is a client-side mount table completely. So server doesn't aware of it, how what mount points you have configured. So it's a completely the in-memory tree maintains at the client side. It's a lightweight in-memory tree for your mount points, what you configured. To use VFS, obviously, as I discussed, you have to use your own new scheme, that is a VFS. So to visualize a little bit the VFS, how it look like. So if, for example, if you configure some mount points, something like data pointing to O3FS and the user folder pointing to Hadoop cluster user and backup folder pointing to S3A. So you would configure the mount points to these three folders to respect to target clusters. So then the view file system loads these mount points in your in memory tree, something like this. And every call comes to the view file system, it checks the mapping to the target file system, and it delegates the call according to that path mapping. The main use cases was the main motivation for building VFS was the HDFS federation, and also federating heterogeneous file systems, and as well as hybrid cloud transparency. You can configure multiple cloud file systems as well, like ABFS and SCA, and as well as on-premise file systems, multi-cloud transparency as well. So we can only configure multiple cloud file systems underneath. The challenges today, the users have to change their path schemes. For example, if you are already running HDFS cluster, so your paths might have been stored in Metastores, like Hive Metastore stores is a complete qualified URI path. So similarly, if application stores their complete qualified paths in that stores, so if you want to change your file system, then you have to upgrade your Metastores as well. That's kind of painful. And as well as today, VFS has the configurations at the client side. So users have to take care of copying all the configurations to across all the client nodes. So that's also could be error prone and painful to the users. So these two challenges we had identified from existing for view file system. So the solutions we will discuss, how we overcome that solutions and how we solve the problems. So before that, what are the goals we put? Like, we should be able to support what VFS is supporting today, all the use cases, and as well as admin should be able to place a mount configuration file in a central place instead of users to configure in all the client nodes. Users should be able to keep at the central place. Users should not be bound to the single scheme. Like today, it's bound to VFS scheme. So users should be able to use this as a tool, and they should be able to use it as any other file system. For example, today your cluster is HDFS. VFS should work like HDFS for you, and you should be able to provide additional mount points on top of it. So let's look at this scheme problem. So VFS scheme, how we solved users can migrate to any other scheme. So we simply extended view file system itself. So because we kept the goal as we wanted to support all the VFS use cases, so we extended the view file system. So we get the view file system behaviors for free for us. So then we had introduced a new class called view file system overload scheme, which extends view file system. And because of that, we were able to easily support all the VFS use cases. And also another advantage we get is the key patterns, what we configuration patterns. So we don't need to learn the new configuration key patterns. So what if you are aware of VFS configurations, we should be able to simply use the same configurations. And the additional configuration you may have to do is we have to reset the respective file system which you wanted to overload. For example, today's file system is FS/HDFS. Distributed file system. Then you may want to reset that FS/HDFS IMPL with view file system overload scheme. This is one time configuration at the core-side.xml. Or if you want to overload this with the SRE file system, so you can also do that. You can reset the fs.s3a ampl with VFS overload scheme. Allow any scheme to use in a mount fs. Like s3a, you are able to use it now, and HDFS, you can use it now. Any Hadoop compatible file system scheme, you should be able to use it part of this VFS now. The acting URI, that is initializing URI, URI's authority part should be your mount table name. In the mount table, you will configure the mount table name. Also, you would provide in the key name. So you have to use the same authority name so that the VFS overload scheme will be able to identify the respective mount table configuration for you. We will look that key part, how it look like in the next slides. So let's quickly compare on the today's your existing HDFS file system versus this view file system configurations, how they look like and how they will act. So for example, you are using HDFS NS1 as your URI, default URI, and the by default it points to the distributed file system class. So it only contacts the single name node in this configuration. Once you migrate to this VFS overload scheme, so you would continue to keep the same URI. So the users will continue to use the same starting with HDFS:NS1, and then you would provide additionally the links underneath. So this configuration key pattern is same as VFS. So you would provide NS1 as a mount table name, that is authority part here we just discussed in the previous slide. And the path what you wanted to point was mount point was app data to you are wishing to go the app data to cluster B app data. So you configure here in this example, you provided three mount points: app data, and user. So one is to HDFS, another is to Ozone, other is to again HDFS. So let us say your file is coming, your input file is coming with this path, HDFS NS1 app data my file, then this file will be created in cluster B app data because you have provided a mount point here. And as well as if your input file is coming something like data my data, then it would go to the Ozone. And if your input path is coming to the user, then it would go to the user. So let's visualize how you can configure with a pretty much same configuration set. You would be able to manage two different set of schemes. For example, the first example is showing like your existing cluster is HDFS cluster. So you just provided a mount points to the data, user, and backup. And in this right side, your example is S3A. I mean, your existing cluster today is S3A. You wanted to get a more mount points. So users will be able to continue to use S3A paths itself, and they would be able to delegate the calls to different file systems underneath as a mount points. You have to note that the bucket TA should be your mount table name in this key. For example, in a previous slide, we have seen instead of NS1, you would provide bucket TA in the configuration key set so that it will pick up the respective configuration from your file. So another important topic, I'll just start introducing from here, that here you might have seen that you have provided only three folders. So users mount view will be just three folders. So they would not be able to see, that is the today's VFS implementation. So whatever folders you wanted to view from the root, you should be able to provide a mount, then only you would be able to view it. So the user starting from the root, they would only see data, user, backup. So if your existing cluster has much more folders, obviously it will be. So you would not be able to view them from the root. So to overcome that, we have option called link fallback. This acts like exactly a default cluster. So we can configure something like this in the second point. The link fallback is a key. So NS1 link fallback, you can provide whatever default cluster you wanted to view. So if your existing cluster is HDFS NS1, you configure the link fallback with HDFS NS1. So the view from the root, you would look like the link fallback, that is HDFS NS1, the file system tree plus VFS inode tree. Whatever the mount points you configured, that is a VFS inode in-memory tree plus the link fallback. This is the tree. So we will represent this as a merge view between the link fallback and VFS inode tree. So for example, if any other path is coming in the previous example, any other path, for example, root from the slash test. So since there is no mount point you provided explicitly, so it will go to the fallback. So NS1 test it will create, something like that. So once you enable this link fallback, so any path you don't have in a mount path point to point links, so then it would go to the fallback. Let's visualize that. So how the tree represents. So today's cluster, your today existing cluster, let us say HDFS NS1. So this is your tree in your HDFS NS1. You have folders like backup, user, warehouse, and inside backup, you have backup file and hive. So you have also provided a mount points for a backup folder. You want to go to S3A bucket A, and data folder, you want to go to Ozone. So you have this mount tree. So for the user, the mount, the complete tree will look like this. So it's a merge view between this your default as well as the in-memory mount trees. So it won't load the default cluster's tree into the memory, but logically it considers to do LS on fallback when it wants to do LS on root, for example. So here you need to note that there is a backup file in default cluster, as well as you have provided a mount point for backup folder. Both you have. This is a conflicting. So we will give a high priority to the link because your intention is to provide the mount point to the backup folder. So the files, whatever you have in the default cluster under the backup folder will be hidden. They will not be deleted. They will be just hidden to you. So you need to... the admins would be able to view it by setting -D option with fshdfsimpl equal to distribute file system. Then you would be able to view this one. Because the client said we had reset that file system implementation with view file system overload scheme, right? So this is it for the scheme problem. This is how we try to achieve like a transparency globally. And now let's come to the mount table configuration problems. We had come up with two solutions here. One is xinclude, and HTTP server. So by default, most of you might know that our Hadoop configuration supports hex include tag. You can just provide your any other remote paths in the href link in the hex include tag itself, so that our configuration class would automatically load that file as well into the configurations. So we can take advantage of it. And you configure from any remote HTTP path, you can also keep in Hadoop web HDFS URI. I mean, you can keep somewhere in HDFS and configure the web HDFS path. So you can keep all the configurations, mountable configurations in a separated file and configure that path, what I mean. So this tag you have to add in a course-added.xml. So wherever the course-added.xml is getting loaded, it will also download this mountable XML file and it will consider that keys as well. So users need not, the advantage here is users need not copy this configuration file to all the clients. You will just keep in place wherever the course-added.xml is getting loaded, this configuration also will get loaded. There are some advantages and disadvantages. So the advantages here are no code changes because Hadoop configuration supports reading hex include tag, and job clients will get all the from a client side itself and pass to all the servers. So it loads the course-added.xml at its client itself. And the disadvantages are web HDFS doesn't support HA. That's one drawback. So you may need to have your own, if you want to support HA, you may need to have your own IA available HTTP path. And another, the major disadvantage here is Hadoop configuration opens the HTTP connections directly. It doesn't go through authentication mechanisms. So it doesn't really use any of the Hadoop security mechanisms. So insecure environments, I don't think this is a viable option. So let's look into the next option, which is what we recommend. So you can copy this mountable configuration file in any Hadoop file systems or any other file system, Hadoop compatible file system. You can place the file there and just configure that path in course-added.xml. Like VFS mountable path. So you keep all the configuration keys there and just configure this path. So the VFS overload scheme will load this configuration file when it is initializing. If you keep in HDFS, you can keep replication for this file is very high, so that every node will have this file available so that they can load it quickly as a local file. The advantage here is HA will come for free. Like if you use any of the, most of the HCFS file systems will have high available support. And security also will get for free because Hadoop client layers, most of the client layers will have their own security mechanisms. And the disadvantage here could be that wherever this file system is getting initialized, it will try to download this file. So we have mitigations to set this mountable path as null if you already loaded the configuration files. Or you can keep the high replication so that the file will be treated as simply local file. So I'll move to the next topic. So the upstream project integration efforts where we had integrated this, it integrated on MR and Yarn. I tried testing there. So it's working pretty much fine in both secure and non-secure environments. Basically what I did is I put a source data in HDFS and target path, I gave it as a mount path, which supposed to copy into a remote cluster, which I pointed as the ozone. So it's working well. And as well as I also try DCP, you can create some files in HDFS and just run the DCP job by giving us a mounted path which points to the ozone or any other cluster. And we also tried with Hive. So Hive partitioning use case, which we'll discuss in detail in later section. And also, when we enable encryption, so we have seen some issues because they are assuming it as a distributed file system because the URI scheme is HDFS colon. So they are doing some class castings. So we are throwing exceptions there. So, and as well as HBase was not starting because of this same issue, class cast issues, because they are also casting it to distributed file system. So where we had set this class to UFS forward scheme. So then we had started thinking into what could be the potential solution for this. Then we came up with a Vue distributed file system. So to solve specifically for HDFS issues, where in the class, where kind of class cast issues. So instead of users configuring VFS overload scheme, they can just configure Vue distributed file system, which simply extends distributed file system so that the class cast issues will not come. So in Vue distributed file system, what we have done was it just tries to initialize some mounting file system inside it. So the Vue file system overload scheme will be initialized inside Vue distributed file system. And it also creates all the in-memory tree and blah, blah, blah. So in case if user doesn't really want the mount points, it just works like a distributed file system today. So if there are no mount, if it is failed to initialize mounting file system, that means if you don't configure any of the mount points, it will just fail to initialize. So in that case, it will just fall back to a distributed file system itself. So even if you enable it, Vue distributed file system is today, so if you don't have any mount points, it just works like a distributed file system itself. So it provides completely compatible compatibility to you. So you won't see any differences. So if users wanted to use the mounting functionality under a distributed file system, they can just configure the keys, mount point keys. So then when the file system is initialized, it would start using the VFS and inside the Vue distributed file system. So we have looked at this visualization before. It's slight change now, which is like, you would, instead of configuring VFS overload scheme as a FS HDFS IMPL, now you would configure, now you would be configuring Vue distributed file system class, so which extends the distributed file system, and your URI initializing URI would be HDFS NS1. You continue to use the same URI, and inside that it would initialize the Vue file system overload scheme. So this will load all the client-side mount tables, everything as we discussed in the previous slides. It just works. So any call coming to the Vue distributed file system, if VFS is successfully initialized inside, so it will just delegate the calls to VFS file system scheme. So you would just get all the mounting functionality under the distributed file system itself. So as I said, FS HDFS IMPL, you should configure with Vue distributed file system class now. So, and this is specifically for HDFS users. All other file systems where they don't have class casting problems, they can directly use Vue file system overload scheme itself, because if applications are not casted to the specific file systems, then they don't need to have this another additional wrapper at all. So, but in HDFS case, unfortunately, many of the applications has casted and directly access a lot of internal APIs. So now we see no class cast issues anymore. And if there are no mount points configured, then no behavioral change. It works exactly like distributed file system, because it just extends from distributed file system. And when there are no mount points, we just call super dot all the APIs. So the DFS specific APIs, if only DFS specific APIs, example eraser coding or encryption, such APIs, when application is calling, it would only work if the file system is, the path is pointing to the HDFS. So for example, if the path is pointing to the Ozone, and if you are calling EC APIs on that path, so then it would not work, right? So because right now Ozone doesn't have EC supported APIs. Most of the EC APIs are like administrative APIs here. So for that, the applications can use a resolve path and make sure that path is HDFS. So you can do this one. You can call on the path, the resolve path. So on that, you can also call get URI and check the scheme. So the resolve path, what it does is it will try to resolve the path where it's exactly going to the target, and that path it will give you. So from there, the scheme, you can check what scheme it is. Based on that, you can also decide whether you want to make a call or not. So with the Hive and whatever applications I tried now so far, I haven't seen much issues with that. But in case if users are specifically calling on every path or something like that, then they can have these checks. Let's look at the last use case, which is one of the interesting case. I put here step by step how to verify this one. So let's go through the steps quickly. Let's say your existing cluster today is HDFS NS1. So you have some folder structure, something like Hive sample data, temp, or some and so on. So you make sure you configure link fallback as your default cluster, pointing to this one. So then I have a table. I have a table which has some data and four columns in it. So I just copied this file into sample dataset folder. So this is a query for creating an external table in Hive. So you can create an external table from the sample dataset path. So the table name is sales, and create, the idea is to partition the table by state. So you create another table which partitioning by state. So the second query is will do that for you. Create table sales by state. And also we have to load the data into this table, sales by state table. Let's look at that query. So this is the query. We can insert the data from the sales table data. It queries all the data and it tries to insert into sales by state by partitioning the state. So once you run this query, if you look at the HDFS path, so it would have been partitioned by state, something like this. You would see the folder in a managed table folder path. So all the managed tables will be kept under this managed Hive sales. This is the sales by state table name. So now you see the partition folders. So now the idea is, from the this is exist in HDFS. Now the idea is we wanted to move some or one or couple of partitions from HDFS to a remote cluster. Our goal is to move to Ozone here. So let's see how we can move it. So now make sure you create the same path there. So for the simplicity, you can copy to anywhere and point the target mount point to that path. But keeping the same folder structure will make you clarity on where you copied the data, right? So once you create this directory, so you may have to create in a recursive way for each and every folder here. I just put it as like a single path. So then you do a DCP from the source folder to target path. Once you done that, you can delete your source data, or if you want to keep it around for some time, it's fine, because once you add a mount point, this path, old path, will be completely hidden. You would not be able to see it anymore. I mean, data will be there until this you are accessing via this VFS. That folder will be hidden, that we discussed before. Once copied, you can add a mount point to that path. This is the way you can add a mount point. NS1 warehouse table, this is the source path. So that path I have copied to DCP to O3FS and sales by state folder. So it would have been created the folder. This state by state, I mean, state equal to CA would have been copied under this folder. So in Ozone. So once you had done this one, refresh the cluster. So then you would see, if you do LS, you would see this folder is fetched. Still you would see this folder, because the RVFS would be able to get from all the file systems and show you as a merge view. So since it is this folder is actually fetching from Ozone, and you can also notice this, the user has been HDFS because we use the user as HDFS. So the rest other folders are created by Hive itself, right? Now let's query and see whether you're able to get the data. So yeah, this is a query to just look at it. So this data is getting pulled from Ozone now because you don't you had provided a mounting path to pointing to Ozone. So let's see, that is a reading part. Let's see whether it is able to update any of the rows in it. So this is a query, we can update the rows. So I had just give some dummy values here. So just to see whether it is updating, then we had queried. So yes, it's able to update in Ozone. So we are able to run the queries transparently from the user's perspective, wherever the data goes, move around to the different clusters. So this is about this use case. So this most of the work has been done in this Jira, HDFS 15289. We are continuing to improve more and more. And the Hadoop repo, you all know that. So the Ozone repo as well, I'm listed here. So please come and join in Apache Ozone, and a lot of active work we are doing, like upcoming eraser coding and a lot of other features we'll be working on. And as well as Hadoop HDFS side also, we are keep improving some things. Please join. Yeah, thanks to all the following collaborators who involved in the design discussions, code, and reviews. So a lot of people involved from Cloudera, and as well as Warley discussed some with some Twitter folks, and as well as LinkedIn guys also contributed some parts. And from Huawei and Microsoft also has been involved in some of the reviews and discussions. Yeah, let's look at the Q&A part now. How it will ensure the strong consistency as it object stores? Most of the architecture details, if you look at it, it follows similar to the HDFS fashion. So the commit block and updating into metaspace. So it provides in that perspective, it just gets by default consistency as the design, most of the design aspects followed HDFS fashion. Any other questions? Okay. Looks like let me wait for a few more minutes if there are any more questions. Thanks, Brahma. So looks like no much questions. Do you need SSL to enable security? Since we provide this as client side mount points, so the client side file system configurations as you configure for any other file system when you use it as independently, the same configurations would apply here. So you just configure the client side configurations, whatever is required for that SSL or Kerberos support or anything. So you just configure the same for that file system and just configure that path as a mount point into this VFS. So it would, the client would be able to use all of your client-side configurations. For example, I ran Ozone plus the HDFS paths. So I'm able to use both clients with the respect to Kerberos or delegation tokens. It would be able to load all the delegation tokens from all the underneath file systems, and it would be able to contact to the respective files. Similar way, SSL and any other encryption and everything should work. Yes, the, that is for Ozone as well. Both Ozone already supports that security configuration. The same configuration stuff you will configure. Thanks, Ishin. Thanks, Dinesh. Yeah, when basically you are wanted to try or experiment with Ozone, this is a this tool will help you to easily point some of your folders to Ozone and try running on that Ozone with your applications and see how things goes. Then we can eventually move some of your data from HDFS to Ozone as well, and vice versa. So transparently for the user, most of the stuff it should work for you. Thanks, Bharat. Yeah, I think. Yeah, looks like no other questions. Then did I miss anything? No, I think we pretty much we answered. Yeah, I think we'll end the session now. Thank you so much for joining with me today, and have a nice day and stay safe, everybody. Thank you.